Sabbath, everyone. Let's see how this goes. All right, look at that, on the first track, amen. Again, happy Sabbath, everyone. Very happy to see a lot of new faces, and also seeing quite a few faces I haven't seen in a while. My boy Hervins is... I'm glad to see you. Is Dorothy around? Oh, there she is, right next to her. And the boys. Oh, man, they're big. So how many of you have been around in this church at least 10 years? Quite a few of you. Quite a few of you. So the sermon today is going to sound a little familiar. It's amazing how time flies, and... you know, you get to the point where there's sermons that you could repeat again because it's been a long time. It's been almost 11 years since I actually gave this message, and it was just felt appropriate for the time. So I wanted to share it with you again. But before that, of course, let us start with a word of prayer. Our gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, it is great to be in your house. It is great to see, Lord, people from all over, people who we have never met before, come and join us to worship and glorify your name. Lord, it's also amazing to see old friends and loved ones that you missed. And Lord, we ask for your presence this morning in each one of our hearts, in each one of our minds, Lord. We ask for the Holy Spirit to guide us as we listen to your word. Lord, speak for me, speak through me, and may the words that come out of my mouth, Lord, be ones that reach our souls, Lord, and lead us to a place where we want to change, if we need to make a change, Lord. Encourage us in every way, and Lord, guide us to the day that we'll one day see you coming in the clouds. So, Father, thank you again for this privilege. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. So, today I'm going to share with you, like I said, a message that I shared a long time ago. And as I was sitting here thinking, right, you know, when the whole, you know, praise team is going and children's story, you're kind of thinking, okay, going over everything in your mind, you know, a thought came to me, and I'm just going to share right off the bat, okay, because it really, the sermon is about the Christian lifestyle, okay, the Christian experience, and what I'm going to share, they are what I feel is the ideal way to live. And so if you find yourself, as you're listening to these four little principles, okay, and you feel like, man, I am nowhere near that, don't be discouraged, okay? Don't be discouraged. As I said, I preached this sermon almost 10 years ago, and there were some things that I looked at and I said, you know what, I probably should have visited this more often than 10 years. Because even me, in my own life, I can recognize there's some things that I've maybe went backwards on, and I am not meeting the ideal that I'm going to share with you today. So please, as I go through this, do not feel in any way that because you're not meeting these standards, that God is not on your side, okay? So I wanted to share this again also because of something that recently happened to me. And I shared with the congregation a few Sabbaths back that I had the privilege to take part in a trial, right? I live in Enfield now, so I had to go down to the Hartford court. And, you know, I've done jury duty many, many times before, right? It seems like they have my name on a Rolodex that every 3 years on the dot, boom, they just call me. It's like, come on, I just did this, you know? But it seems like it was my turn again. Now, in years past, it's one of those things. Springfield does it a little different. They call a bunch of people, and then they send half of us home. So when I did it here in Massachusetts, I never had to go into the courtroom. You know, I usually just got sent home. So it was really kind of a nuisance. I got to sit what I felt was like a punishment for about 3 hours in a room with a bunch of strangers, and really nothing came of it. In Connecticut, they actually do it a little different, I believe, and I don't know if because of COVID or what, but they only call about 30 people a day. And Hartford is a big city, so it's not like there's not a lot of cases going on. But you could almost guarantee that if you show up that day, you will be going into the courtroom and you're going to be interviewed. And I got to say, it is a shaking experience. Because they sit you down to see if you would be a good juror for this certain case. And they sit you down, and you're at the witness stand, and they just start asking you questions. And very personal questions at that, at times. And you're like, in my mind, I'm going, am I the one on trial? What did I do? Did I get charged with something? Because they're asking me questions, and I'm like, I'm a little nervous, too, because here's this person that has been charged with a crime who's sitting, I don't know, 10 feet away from me. And here I am answering personal questions like, hey, yeah, I live in Enfield, or this is where I work. And I'm like, if this guy right now is innocent, right, in the eyes of the law, but if he's guilty, I don't want him to have this information. You know, so it's a little shaking when you're sitting there, right? But I will say, it was a wonderful experience going through it, okay? While I did not want to do it, it definitely became something that I won't say I'm looking forward to doing it again, but if it comes up, I definitely will have a different attitude towards it. Now, one of the things that the first day of trial, they sit you down and they talk. Most of the first day was giving us very specific instructions. I mean, one of the things that I learned is that the law is very specific. The law is very specific. And so, you know, you hear these terms and they are explaining these terms. And one of the terms that you will hear more often than not, and if you've ever been part of a trial or, you know, you've watched, you know, Law and Order on TV or, you know, any of those shows, right, you would have heard of a term. Okay. See, now it didn't work. You will hear of a term that is called reasonable doubt. You know, reasonable doubt is something that they explain to us, you know, before the case gets started. And it's very important because it is the standard of proof that the state has to meet for someone to be found guilty or innocent. And if you think about it, I mean, can we say or can we think that there's always doubt, right? I mean, if you weren't there physically, you know, there could be doubt, right? So I was thinking right off the bat, it's like, okay, how does anybody then get found guilty? If this is the standard to find people guilty, right? But as they explain it, right, it is proof that after you as a juror listening to this proof and seeing the evidence that is introduced, right, you as a reasonable person, you as a reasonable human being, in your mind, you could honestly tell you to yourself that person is guilty or that person is innocent, okay? Now, I found it also, I appreciate the justice system because while sometimes we think maybe the justice system is unfair, it does have, again, an interesting aspect to it where if you feel 99% that this person is guilty, but there's just a little bit of doubt that maybe that person didn't do it, the court asks you to find this person innocent. And I thought, man, that's pretty wild, right? Now, why is this important? So our justice system is based on something called Blackstone's formulation. And it is basically this idea, and you, again, probably have heard this before. It says that better than that 10 guilty persons escape or go free, that one innocent person suffer. And I like that. I like that. Because, you know what? While we all want justice, one of the things that we could all agree that one of the most unjust things would be innocent people to suffer, right? So, again, our judicial system is based on this. And believe it or not, I'll say to you that there is some biblical evidence to this, right? Or precedence to this. If you go to the book of Genesis, there was a time, right, that Abraham met these three strangers, right? And he brought them into their home. And who did they end up being? Angels. Angels and Jesus, the Lord, right? The Bible says the Lord, right? And the Lord reveals what they're going to be doing when they leave Abraham. They're going to head down to Sodom and Gomorrah, right? And again, thinking back to all these Bible stories, who was living in Sodom and Gomorrah at that time? Lot, his nephew, Abraham's nephew, right? And we see Abraham plead to God that, listen, hey, he starts with a very high number, right? Maybe you all remember the story. But if, you know, 50 people are found innocent, will you, you know, forgive them? How about 20? And then he stops at 10, right? And the Lord's reply is like, yeah, even if there's 10 people innocent, I'll forgive them all. Like, I will not destroy the city. You know, amazingly enough, not even 10 people were found in the city. Just four, I guess you could say three, right? You know, Lot, his two daughters, the wife sort of escaped, right? But, you know, so I don't know. So we see that God is a God of mercy, right? A God who is willing to forgive and doesn't want innocent people to suffer. Now, again, I ask, maybe you're wondering, okay, Josh, where are you going with this? Where are we going with the courts and stuff like that? You're going to talk about judgment? In reality, no. I'm really going to talk about, again, Christian principles, your Christian lifestyle, and I want to base it on this premise, on this question. Again, thinking back to what we just talked about, our judicial system, you know, how there cannot be any reasonable doubt, right? If there's reasonable doubt, you must find a person innocent. Let me ask you this. If today you were arrested and charged with the crime of being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? I want you to think about this, right? Is there enough evidence in the life that you are living to convict you of being guilty of the charge of being a Christian? Now, you know, if someone right now, we're going to do an investigation and go deep into your work life, go deep into your home life, right? Go deep into those sites that you visit. Would you be acquitted of the charge of being a Christian? So in everything that we do, friends, we give a testimony, right? You know, during the trial, people came and gave their testimony, right? And it was very, again, very specific, right? But when it comes to our lives, we give testimony in everything that we do, right? You know, what is the testimony that you give at work? Are you that person who just always seems to have something to complain about? Are you that person that's willing to help out, you know, when people are called upon? What is the testimony that you give at your place of work? What is the testimony that you give at home? You know, because sadly, there's a lot of Christians, right, that they come to church, and man, they are great Christians in church. And then it seems like when they get in their car, they take off their costume, and they're a completely different person. And your children see somebody different than the elders and the pastor and the other members of the church see, right? So what is the testimony that you are giving at home? What is the testimony also that you give at church? Because sometimes, and I don't want to, again, I don't want anyone to feel insulted with what I'm saying. This is about thinking and honestly seeing yourself where, you know, self-reflection, right? Where do I find myself, right? So we say, too, that, man, church is so important to us. But do we get involved? You know, does church to us start in Friday evening and ends on Saturday evening? Or is it something like, you know what? It is a full-time experience. So again, what is the testimony that you are giving? And again, is that testimony strong enough to convict you of being a Christian? So again, as I mentioned, there are some principles that I want us to look at. And again, they're not principles that are impossible to attain. I will say that it will require a lot of effort, okay? It will require a lot of dedication. And they could simply be summarized in this passage that is probably very well known to most of us. Okay? And it says, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there is no law, and those who are Christ have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. I don't think this is the first time we've heard this passage, is it? We find it in Galatians 5, 22 to 26. So, again, as you think about your life, are you all those things? Are you all those things all the time? You know, are you someone who demonstrates love and joy and compassion even when faced with tremendous adversity? And again, I'm not looking for an answer, but I'm looking for, again, self-reflection and realizing, you know what, that maybe I have a lot to go. So, you know, when we look at Jesus, Jesus was all those things all the time. Isn't it amazing? Right? You know, even self-control, right? Somebody may question self-control and they say, well, yeah, no, Jesus flipped over those tables at you know, at the sanctuary, right? And he ran all those people off. You know what? I firmly believe Jesus knew exactly what he was doing. He did not lose self-control. He knew exactly what he was doing, and he knew exactly the testimony that he was given at that moment. So Jesus was all these things at the same time, always. There's a little quote that I like. It says, the most powerful argument for the validity of Christianity is a loving and lovable Christian. You know, are we that? When people see us, is that who they see? A loving, kind person. Or someone that they just kind of want to walk maybe on the other side of the hallway, hoping that, you know, we don't have an interaction today because who knows how it might go. So, principle number one that I want to share with you, okay, is live with the mind of Christ. I don't know if it's that visible. should have used a different font. Live with the mind of Christ. You know, many, many years ago, it's sadly that has been something that's forgotten. It kind of came in. It was everywhere. It was, I guess you could call it a fad, right? And then it went away. But you probably, if you're, you know, old enough like me, and probably even a little younger, you probably remember at some point wearing a little bracelet that said WWJD. Huh? There were people who wore the shirts everywhere, right? Does anybody know what that stands for, WWJD? What would Jesus do, right? And it's sad when I think about it that became a fad that kind of went away, because that is one of the most basic principles that we have to live as a Christian, right? In every situation, imagine yourself questioning, how would Jesus handle this situation, right? Because in the end, that's our goal, right? To imitate him, right? So, again, it's sad that kind of went away. But it is something that as Christians, we should always remember, right? You know, Jesus did all these things with other people in mind, right? And imagine if we did that. Imagine if we were obedient like Jesus, right? Because Jesus was obedient to his Father, right? Jesus could have stepped away from the cross, said, I don't want to do this, I'm done, calling it quits, but he didn't, right? Knowing he was going to suffer, right? Jesus went out of his way to find people to help, right? When was the last time we did that, right? Jesus was so connected to the Father that he knew that at times he was going to have to travel far out of his way, right, to go see people that needed him, right? And we see that in the Bible, right? You know, you look at the demoniac in the Gadarenes, right? If you read the story, Jesus is somewhere else, gets on a boat, goes across, right, goes to this village, right, heals this man, and goes back. Like, that was the sole purpose of him crossing, right? Jesus healed the daughter of a Canaanite woman, right? I love that story, by the way. One of my favorite stories, right? The one that the woman said, yeah, but even dogs eat the crumbs of the master's table, of the children's table, right? Oh, I love that story, right? But if you look again at that story, Jesus is somewhere. He's heading somewhere down here. And if actually, if you ever bother to look at it on the map, he just has to go down. Right? But he goes, like, west to Tyre and Sidon, meets this woman, and then goes back. As if the only reason for him to take that detour was this person. So imagine if we lived a life in which we sought out people to help. Because that's what Jesus did, right? So Philippians tells us, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, did not consider robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, taking the form of a bondservant and coming in the likeness of men. Friends, that is a beautiful passage. It's a beautiful passage that when we think about it, again, Jesus didn't have to do any of this stuff. Jesus was too good to become a human being. And yet he did it. Because he felt that our salvation, he felt that you and me were worth it. He didn't have that in his head that, you know what, they're going to deny me. They're not going to accept me. You know, they're going to beat me. No. All that was not anything that would stop Jesus from coming down and taking, as the verse says, this reputation, right? Obedience, I wanted to share also this passage from Desire of Ages. I love some of these quotes, right? All true obedience comes from the heart. It was heart work with Christ, And if we consent, he will so identify himself with our thoughts and aims, so blend our hearts and minds into conformity to his will, that when obeying him, we shall be carrying out for our own impulses. Could you imagine having that mind? That what everything you do, first of all, imagine, you know, so there's so many Christians out there worried, oh man, did I sin today? And so concerned about how much they sin, you know, they sin today. And that's a burden. But could you imagine having the life where every choice that you made, because you are so close with God, would have been the same decision that he made? Man, you don't have to ever worry about sinning ever again. Because even when you make a mistake, you're going to repent and God's going to forgive you, right? So, you know, principle number two is live with praise and glorify God and be joyful. Yeah, amen. Because there are some people out there that claim themselves to be Christians, right? But man, life sucks. Man, life is terrible. You know? So, the psalmist made sure that he knew that we needed to praise, right? Right? Because of your love is better than life. My lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my hands. My soul will be satisfied with the richest foods, and singing lips my mouth will praise. Friends, praising God, glorifying God, and being joyful, it's a life-saving principle. You know, we live in a world that more and more people find no escape to their problems, to their pain, that they view the only solution is suicide. And how sad is that? My friends, we have the answer. We have the answer. And it's actually available to all of us, right? And it is to be joyful. And I know there are, you know, listen, I know there's a lot of things that are right now breaking our minds down that are helping us have mental health issues, all right? I know that's a real thing. But a lot of it is because we focus on what we don't have to focus on, right? You know, Proverbs is very clear, right, on being, on the solution for anxiety, on the solution for, you know, for many illnesses, right? It says, anxiety in the heart of a man causes depression, but a good word makes it glad. Now, that seems silly, right? That seems silly, but friends, I got to tell you, it's so true, you know? And not only for that person who gives a good word, but that person who receives it. You know, I had the privilege yesterday to interact with one of my students. She's the only girl I had in the shop this year. We got our official ninth grade students. And, you know, we started talking, and I could tell she was a little kind of upset and stuff like that. And she goes, "Mister, I wear this necklace," and she showed me those two necklaces, "in honor of my grandfather. I lost him 6 months ago." And I said, "Oh, I'm sorry about that." I said, so like, what makes it special? Did he make it? He's like, "Oh, no, it's just showing me they have my grandfather's ashes in them." I said, "Oh, that's kind of cool, you know." I said, "So you're missing him today?" He's like, "Yeah, you know, I'm a little sad, you know." And I said, "You know what? I'm sorry you're going through that. But I got to tell you, part of me, I'm glad that you had a grandfather, is glad that you had a grandfather that you got to spend some time with. Because, you know, I didn't have that privilege. I never had grandparents. Well, I'm sure they did, but they all died before I was born. So I said, I never had that privilege of knowing what having a grandparent feels like. And I don't have any memories of my grandmother, you know, doing things with a grandmother, doing things with a grandfather. So you know what? I know you're sad, but I kind of envy you a little bit. Because you will always have those good memories." And you know, she went away. She kept working. I could tell her attitude had changed a little bit. You know, she kept every now and then coming back. "Oh, by the way, mister, this is a picture of my grandfather." You know, and I felt good because I was able to just give her some nice words of encouragement. right? So, you know, Proverbs is not lying when they give us this advice. A merry heart makes a cheerful countenance, but sorrow of the heart, the spirit is broken. He says it again, Proverbs 17, a merry heart does good like medicine, but a broken spirit dries the bones. You know, one of the key things for us as Christians, friend, we should be joyful. Being joyful doesn't mean you're going to be happy 100% of the time. Being joyful doesn't mean that you ignore those bad things that are happening to you and you live oblivious to them. No. Okay? But understanding that, you know what? God is on your side. God is going to get you through this, right? And friends, we need as Christians to focus on those things that God has blessed us with already, right? Because we all have something to be thankful for. And I know many times it's difficult to see, right? But we all have something to be thankful for. You know, whether it's, if you're not homeless, you have to be thankful that you have a home. Whether the, you know, whether the roof is leaking or something's happening, at least you're not living on the streets. Be thankful for that. Be thankful for what God has given you. And even if you can't see anything to be thankful for in your life, everything is bad. At the very least, you could be thankful that Jesus died to give you the opportunity to live forever with Him, to have eternal joy. So you have the opportunity, you have the reason to rejoice that this pain at some point will end. And we should be thankful for that. We should be thankful for that. Principle number three is live to be an example. Live to be an example. You know, how we treat others, again, gives testimony on who we are, right? You know, the Bible says that, therefore, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Give no offense either to the Jews or the Greeks or to the church of God. You know, sometimes we don't treat those who think differently than us well. And as a Christian, that is a no-no. Okay? Jesus, in every interaction, even with the Pharisees and the Sadducees, right, He wanted what was best for them. Even when He knew in their heart all they wanted was to do evil to Him, all He worried about was best for them. Even when He rebuked them, even when Jesus rebuked them, He wanted what was best for them. So how do we treat others, right? You know, again, we give testimony on everything that we do. You know, I work, again, at a high school. And if you think the drama only happens with the, you know, the teenage students, you'll be wrong, okay? You know, sometimes the adults have more drama than the kids, right? And I actually had the opportunity last week to go see one of the teachers down, you know, in the first floor. I kind of like to keep to ourselves. Our shop is way in the back of the building. Nobody goes down there unless they absolutely have to. So it's kind of peaceful, right? And I go down, and my coworker goes, Josh, I haven't seen you, you know, in a while. I got to ask you, man. You guys, I got to tell you. You and Marcus, which is my other coworker, the other teacher that works directly with me, he goes, you guys need to give a professional development on how to get along. Because, you know, every shop there's drama, and, like, we never hear anything from you guys. You guys just, like, must get along. I said, you know what? Yeah. I said, I don't see that there's any reason to fight. He has his way, I have my ways. We could always just work together and find a way around it, you know? And so, like, I never realized that that's a testimony that I was giving. I just thought I was, you know, sticking to my and minding my own business. But people were looking at it like, you know what? Those guys never argue. Those guys don't have the drama and the rumors spreading out through all the school, you know, like a lot of other shops. So, you know, again, everything that we do, we testify and we give an example, right? You know, one of the reasons I am sure I value Sabbath school so much, right? Because I mentioned that before. You guys know it. I love Sabbath school, right? And one of the reasons I believe it was because of the example my mother set. Because it didn't, just about any day I was waking up to go to school, to get ready, right? You know, didn't matter which apartment we were living in. As you walked by the dining room table, or there was a little kitchen table inside of the kitchen, right? Guess what I could find every morning? You know, her little cup of decaf, right? Some crackers, and a Bible and her Sabbath school lesson. And, you know, and that is an example that has stayed with me, right? That, hey, this is valuable, right? So in everything that we do, we are to give an example, right? John, 1 John tells us that, but whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk as he walked. Right? Scripture is clear. Our goal is to imitate Jesus, to follow his example. Right? And what will happen is as we follow that example, we will be examples to others, right? And again, friends, I know at some point all of us have failed, right? At some point all of us have given a bad testimony. But it doesn't mean that your ministry is done. You just got to get up and kind of try to fix the situation and keep going, right? Last principle, right? And it is live to minister. Live to minister. 1 Corinthians tells us, I try to please everybody in every way, for I am not seeking my own good, but the good of many, so that they may be saved. Friends, if we want to honor and glorify God, one of the main things that we have to do is minister to those who have not found Jesus yet, and minister to those who are in need. That's it. You know, we cannot glorify God if we are not doing that, right? You know, Jesus himself in Matthew tells us that whoever desires to be first among you, let him be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. You know, that was Jesus' main purpose of coming, to minister to us, to give us a way. Now, there's a saying that there are many people that their only Jesus they will know is you, right? The way you treat people, the way you act in front of them, the way you treat them, right? That might be the only Jesus these people ever meet. So, In every situation, right, we are to minister. And again, it is difficult, right? Because that means that you're going to have to sacrifice your time. That means you may have to sacrifice, you know, comfort. That may mean that instead of going home, you know, a day after work and finally kind of lean back on your recliner and just, you know, watch a little television to desensitize, right? It may mean that you're going to have to put that aside and go help somebody who's in need. So it will require some effort. But friends, this is what God demands. It's what the Master expects. Because that's what he did when he came here, right? Couple of other quotes, and we'll be done actually soon. So, upon us, God has placed a burden of solemn responsibility. God has declared to us, ye are the salt of the earth. The preserving influence that we may exert in the world is bestowed upon us by the Lord. The bounties that we constantly receive from him are to flow through hand and heart to those around us who have not yet become connected to the fountainhead. Friends, that is a very powerful quote. Because you know God has blessed you throughout the week. God has blessed you in your life. And if you do not pass those blessings on, it's going to be nothing but trouble for you. You guys know the Dead Sea, right? Does everybody know why the Dead Sea is the Dead Sea? The Dead Sea is the lowest, is the body of water at the lowest place before sea level anywhere in the world. So what happens is all these rivers and tributaries flow into fresh water, right? They absorb minerals and absorb things, right? Minerals are good for us, right? And they flow into this body of water, and this body of water does nothing but hold it all in. It doesn't allow the water to go anywhere else. So what happens is the water eventually evaporates. It's in a very hot part of the world, right? The water begins to evaporate, and all it leaves is the salt, the minerals, that all these things, all these good things that all these bodies of water brought to it, that's all that's left. So even though all those good things, this was caused the reason why nothing can survive in the Dead Sea. There's no fishes. There's no plant life. It's too salty, right? And all because it could just accept, but it never gives. None of that could go, friends. And that is how the Christian life works. If all you do is take from God, and you never share it, you're nothing but a dead Christian. Many whom God has qualified to do excellent work accomplish very little because they attempt very little. Thousands pass through life as if they had no definite object for which to live, no standard to reach. Such will obtain a reward proportionate to their work. Friends, do you ever feel like your life as a Christian is stagnant? Can it be that you're not just attempting new things? Can it be that you're just not, I'm not saying trying hard enough, right? Because we're not saved by trying, right? We're saved by grace, right? But that you're not allowing God to truly work in your life. You want to just do the bare minimum. Right? You just want to show up, right? You know, go to church, and then that's about it. As a Christian, we're not going to grow, right? You know, we are in January right now. No, February. We just started February, right? Still, a lot of people have memberships to the gym right now, right? They'll start canceling next month. But if you go to the gym and you go, you know, you grab that nice protein smoothie, that pre-workout, and you sit there and you just watch the people work out. And after an hour, wow, that was a great trip to the gym. You leave. How long will it take for you to get in shape? It makes sense, right? It makes sense that that will never happen. So why do we think that as Christians, just coming here and watching and then leaving and nothing happened? Oh, man, I've been in the church 25 years now. And, like, God doesn't use me. Sorry, again, I don't want to go on a tangent. All right, I think this is the last quote that I want to share with you. A consecrated Christian life is ever shedding light and comfort and peace. It is characterized by purity, tact, simplicity, and usefulness. It is controlled by that unselfish love that sanctifies the influence. It is full of Christ and leaves a track of light wherever its possessor may go. Again, asking you to do a little self-reflection. Whenever you go somewhere, is that place better because you're there? Or are you leaving a track of destruction as you walk through life? And again, not everything, we are not maybe there. And it doesn't mean, again, that we will never achieve it. Okay? But if we follow Christ's example, we try to follow these principles, right? We will be that Christian that we all want to be. You know, as Seventh-day Adventists, we believe that there will be many of us that at some point we will be brought before a trial and ask for our testimony. So, friends, is there enough proof right now to find you guilty of being a Christian? And if the answer is no, if you feel right now that the life that you're living, okay, is one that will get you acquitted almost immediately, maybe it's time to change. Okay? So, friends, if you want to be found guilty of being a Christian, of being a follower of Christ, I'm going to ask you, if that is your desire, to please stand up with me and we'll pray and we'll sing our closing hymn. Our gracious and heavenly Father, okay, Lord, I pray that through my words, I was able to honor and glorify you. Lord, I pray that as we heard these words, and maybe some cut us a little deeper than we wanted to, Lord, may our reaction not be of anger or resentment or hate. Lord, may we have the desire in our hearts to change. May we have the desire every day, every moment, in every situation, Lord, to be just as you were. Lord, that when we read the fruit of the Spirit passage in Galatians, Lord, that people could see every single one of those things in our lives. Lord, we want to be just like you. We want you, Lord, to be proud of us. We know you love us. And now, Lord, we want to demonstrate our love back to you by being just like you, by imitating you in everything that we do. So, Father, be with us. Thank you for blessing us, and thank you for loving us, even when we come up short. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.